This is Rio of Madison Rising, and you're listening to our acoustic version of the Star Spangled Banner here on KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
Oh, say, can you see by the dawn's early light what so proudly we hailed at the twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes in bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets rang.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign. KLRN Radio has advertising rates available. We have rates to fit almost any budget. Contact us at advertising@klrnradio.com.
You're listening to the Spark Radio Network, internet radio like you've never heard before. Innovation, creativity, and imagination are all said to begin with a spark. So fasten your seatbelt and take the ride of your life and listen for the spark. God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Saturday and Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on KLRN Radio and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just 4 simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker.com. That's S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, 2 candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Welcome to God's Pure Word of Faith. I'm Richard Hardin, and again I want to thank the Lord and the management of KLRN Radio for this great opportunity to share God's Word with you today. I just covered in the last message about the ministry of Jesus, or the purpose. You know, like the good news is that Jesus came and he died according to the scriptures. In 1 Corinthians 15, he died according to the scriptures, he buried according to the scriptures, and he rose again according to the scripture. Well, and why was that good news that he had to go through all that? Well, because of the curse of the law in the Old Testament. And the only way the curse of the law could be fulfilled is if we had a perfect sacrifice to take our place. Because back in the Old Testament, they had to, you know, go through sacrifices to get forgiveness of their sin. And their sins were covered then until the next time they offered sacrifices and got the forgiveness through the sacrificial animals and everything and sprinkling of the blood. Well, Jesus did that for us. He made a one-time sacrifice because of his perfect walk of faith and the shedding of his blood on the cross. Then he provided the perfect sacrifice, the eternal sacrifice, where we don't have to go back anymore. We just turn to Jesus. The wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. And that's how he provided that for us, if we will just accept his free gift. Then I covered information about what happened to Jesus from his death on the cross till his resurrection, and then his resurrection, the importance of it and what it meant to us. That, like the people in the Old Testament, when they offered sacrifices, they got forgiveness of their sins, and their, you know, sins were covered until the next sacrifice. But we have such a better covenant with the Lord. He wanted a better relationship with us. So we get forgiveness of our sins when we turn to Him and ask forgiveness. But we also get the cleansing from the sin. Ezekiel 36:26, God speaking through the prophet there said, "A new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart of the flesh, give you heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you." See, that's what happens to us. We get so much more than the forgiveness. As great as that is, the forgiveness, and then God completely forgets our sins in. But we get the new heart and His Spirit in us, and we become a child of God. We're born again then into the body of Christ, into the, you know, God's family, by the Spirit coming into our heart when He changes us. Well, see, now today I'm going to be talking about the Trinity, the relationship of God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And then following up next Sunday, I'm going to continue then to look at some of the relationship between Jesus and Christ, and explain it further Sunday. But today I'm going to try to share with you about the Trinity. And like I said, I'll have some new information for you. You know, when you meet a new person in our society, and you're going to have a relationship with them, like a new employee, or you go to a new job yourself and meet the new boss or something like this, one of the first things you start doing is conversing back and forth, you know, kind of asking questions and sharing your likes and dislikes and seeing what their likes and dislikes are, so you can get to know them. Because in this relationship, you're expected, you know, to fit in some way or another. Well, that's the way it is with the Lord. When we come and invite Him to come into our heart, and He comes into our heart, and we become a child of God, we need to be studying this relationship of God and what kind of characteristics He has. You know, if you have a boss that dislikes certain things, well, you certainly don't want to start doing those things. You know, as soon as you become an employee, you want to keep from doing those type things. But first, in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2, it says, "Grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord." So the more we can know and understand about God and the type of relationship we should have, like it says in, let's see, Hebrews 11:6, one of the most important scriptures to tell us about our relationship between us and God is that in Hebrews 11:6 it says, "But without faith it's impossible to please God, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is," you know, that he is God, that he can do these things, and the promises he's given us, he can back them up, but must, "For he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him." But that first statement there, "But without faith it's impossible to please God." See, now this is a big, important scripture for our relationship with God. We can only please Him through faith, it says. Now, faith comes by hearing the word of God, but only if we accept and obey what we hear. So, for us to be pleasing to God, we've got to be accepting His word, and it's got to be His pure word. It can't be just anything you decide sounds good or something. But anyway, we need to be studying about God, and that's what I'm going to share with you this morning. It's about the Trinity, the relationship we have now. In a recent poll I heard being discussed on the radio, the host stated that only about one-third of the people who profess to be Christians in the United States actually believe that Jesus is the only way for a person to be forgiven of sin and made right with God. Also, they stated that many of the leaders do not even believe in the virgin birth. Now see, our image of God is so very critical, for it, you know, it determines how we seek to relate to Him. And to be pleasing to Him, you know, we've got to relate in a certain way. And it also gives us a value or importance of our lives and the lives of others, is how we feel about God and what God expects of us, and things like this. And so I want to try to help clear up some of this confusion now about the images of God and the personality of the Trinity, because these images are so important to us. Now, so, and then I will continue on in the next message and be more specific about, you know, Christ and Jesus and their relationship and things like this. And you probably don't realize it, what I'm getting at now, but you will before the message is over. Now, in the Trinity, you know, the more we can know about God, we hear a lot, at least I hear a lot on radio and television and messages I've heard, that for the Trinity, you must accept it, the Trinity concept, even though you can't apprehend or understand it. But I'm going to explain to you this morning so that you can understand it. Now, it might surprise you for me to say that, and I'm not trying to be, you know, braggadocious or something like that. But if you'll listen in the next few minutes, you'll see. Now, the word Trinity is not mentioned in the Bible. But the doctrine of the Trinity is defined as a coexistence of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Now, the Holy Spirit is Christ, the living Word. And Father wills, the Son performs through His living Word, Christ, who is the same spoken living Word of God that has dealt personally in the lives of mankind throughout the ages. A good example of the Trinity that God gives us is in the Scripture, exists in the relationship of the Pharaoh, Joseph, and their agreement of Word in Genesis chapter 41, or chapters 41 through 50. Now, this relationship between Joseph, the Pharaoh, and ruling Egypt can be compared to the spiritual relationship of God and Jesus and Christ, the living Word, in the Trinity relationship. Now, for those of you that aren't familiar with that story, Joseph was, well, it was Abraham, Isaac, then Jacob. Jacob's youngest son, or, well, the first son of his daughter, Rachel, at the time, his young son, Joseph, didn't get along with his brothers and everything. They had a problem, and his brothers sold him into slavery. He went over into Egypt, and this is starting in chapter 21 of Genesis. And when he got to Egypt, he got put in prison there. He was sold as a slave in Egypt, and then because of some accusations against him, he was put into prison too. But God raised him up to the second highest position in the land of Egypt. The Pharaoh had a dream, and God gave Joseph the interpretation of the dream. And when the Pharaoh recognized, you know, the hand of God in Joseph's life, and his wisdom and everything, he set him over his whole house of Egypt, and all the people of Egypt. So Joseph was, in a sense, just like the Pharaoh of Egypt. The Pharaoh stepped back and let Joseph do the everyday ruling of Egypt. And this is the example, then, of what's happened in God's kingdom. God has, you know, stepped back and let Jesus take over the upfront running of it. Hebrews chapter 1 says, you know, in times past, God did the speaking to the people, and he spoke through the prophets and things like this. But now, Jesus is the, you might say, upfront speaker of the Trinity, and God has stepped back and allowed him to have that position. And his spoken word, Christ, is how Jesus rules the kingdom of God, by his spoken word. Well, Pharaoh exalted Joseph to the second highest position in the kingdom of Egypt, and Joseph ruled by his word. See, and so this is the Trinity relationship here, and as I go through this, then you'll see how this comes about. In Genesis chapter 41, the Pharaoh said to Joseph, "Thou shalt be over my house," speaking of the house of Egypt, "in his kingdom, according to thy word shall all my people be ruled. Only in the throne will I be greater than you." And the Pharaoh said unto Joseph, "I am Pharaoh, and without thee shall no man lift up his hand or foot in the land of Egypt." Jesus now is over the house of God. In Hebrews 10:21 it says, "And having a high priest over the house of God." In Hebrews 3:6 the scripture states, "But Christ Jesus, as a son over his own house, whose house we are." We Christians are the lively stones, it says, that are used to build God's spiritual house in 1 Peter 2:5. Ye also, as lively stones, are built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God by Jesus Christ. Now, see, the Father stepped back, like the Pharaoh stepped back with Joseph, and has given Jesus the authority to rule by his word. And his living word now is Christ. This is Hebrews chapter 1, verses 1 through 2. God, who at sundry times and divers manners spake in time past unto the fathers by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by his Son, whom he has appointed heir of all things, by whom also he made the worlds. This is in Matthew 28:18. And Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power and authority is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Now, we are the spiritual house of the Father, his children. You know, when we receive the Spirit of Christ in our heart, and we become a child of God, and we receive the new heart, we're born into the family of God. See, we're his spiritual house here on earth. Jesus is our high priest, a Savior and Lord over the Father's house. Joseph was the ruler or Lord over the Pharaoh's house in Egypt. Joseph's word had all the authority of the Pharaoh. And in Genesis 41:22, the Pharaoh gave Joseph his ring of authority. The Pharaoh took off his ring from his hand and put it upon Joseph's hand. Jesus' word has all the power of the spiritual kingdom or house of God, as stated in Matthew 28:18, all power in the heaven and earth given unto me. Jesus also says in John 12:49, now, for I have not spoken of myself, but the Father which sent me, he gave me a commandment that I should say what I should say, what I should speak. And again, Jesus in John 5:26-27 says, for as the Father has life in himself, so hath he given to the Son to have life in himself, and has given him, speaking of Jesus, authority to execute judgment also, because he is the Son of Man. Now, in John 10:30, I and my Father are one. Jesus says that the Spirit is in him, and the Spirit in him is the Father, you know, the living Word. Now see, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was God. See, God the Father and his spoken Word are one and the same. It's just that when God speaks, then we say Christ goes forth, and he's a creating power of the universe. In 1 Corinthians 1:24, it says, Christ, the power of God and the wisdom of God. So Christ is the creating power of God that performs all of the actions that God speaks. And he's certainly the wisdom of God because he's the spoken word of God. So Christ is all power, creating power then. And Apostle Paul states in Colossians 1:19, says that, for it pleased the Father in him, Jesus, should all fullness dwell. And then recognizing that a mediator is normally between two beings, the Apostle Paul states that about Jesus and God in Galatians 3:20, says, now a mediator is not a mediator one, but God is one. See, he saw that, you know, Jesus is not just our mediator with God. He was exalted through that position to the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Now, the Pharaoh exalted Joseph above all others in the land of Egypt. God the Father has exalted Jesus above all others in his spiritual house or kingdom. Apostle Peter says in Acts 5:31, him Jesus has God exalted with his right hand to be Prince and Savior, for to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. Now, see, to be able to be to give forgiveness of sins, that means Jesus, you know, is God now. He's, you know, in the fullness of Godhead bodily. Acts 4:12 says, neither is there salvation in any other, for there's none other name under heaven given among men whereby we might be saved. In Hebrews 12:2, looking in Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down on the right-hand throne of God. Now, because of what the man Jesus suffered and allowed the Father to do in him, in his heart, through the spoken living word, Christ, the Father requires that we come to him for salvation through Jesus. Jesus was exalted by the Father to become Lord of our lives and Savior for our sin debt. The Pharaoh exalted Joseph over all others in the land of Egypt, and the people of Egypt all and other lands had to turn to Joseph for their salvation, which in that day, you know, the physical salvation was food. When the famine came, they all had to come to Joseph. Now, when the people did turn to the Pharaoh during that time, though, for food or during a famine, in Genesis 41:55, the people cried unto Pharaoh for bread. And Pharaoh said unto all the Egyptians, go to Joseph, what he says to you, do it. This is what God said to Peter and James and John on the, you know, Mount of Transfiguration. He says, and they came. There came a voice out of the cloud saying, this is my beloved son, hear him. Notice that Pharaoh made all the people go to Joseph for salvation, their food. The Father makes us go to Jesus for salvation, for our sin debt, the spiritual food. In Genesis 41:43, people were required to bow their knees to Joseph. And he, Pharaoh, made Joseph to ride in the second chariot, which he had, and the people cried before him, bow the knee. And the Pharaoh made Joseph ruler all the land of Egypt. Now in Philippians 2, 5 and 11, Apostle Paul says, let this man be in you who is in Christ Jesus, who being the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal to God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of servant, and was made in likeness of men. Being found in fashion as man, he humbled himself and became obedient to death, even death of the cross. Wherefore God has highly exalted him, Jesus, and given him a name which is above every name, that the name of Jesus, now here, every knee should bow, of things in heaven, things in earth, things under the earth, that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. So see, Joseph, everybody had to bow their knee to him. God says everybody has to bow their knee to Jesus. If you don't bow here on earth, you'll bow later. But now, Joseph's words were the life to the Egyptian. And Jesus says in John 6:63 that his words are spirit and they're life for us. Joseph ruled the kingdom of Egypt through his word. Jesus rules the kingdom of God today through his words. Jesus' words will be our judge, as Jesus states in John 12:48. He that rejects me and receiveth not my words has one that will judge him. And you know, the living word is Christ now. It says one that will judge him. The word that I have spoken, the same shall judge him in the last day. And see, we're all going to have to appear before that judgment seat of Christ. Words that Jesus spoke then and the words he speaks now to us are Christ, the living word. And Apostle Paul states in Romans 14:10, we shall all stand before the judgment seat of Christ, for it is written, as I live, saith the Lord, every knee shall bow to me and every tongue shall confess to God. So then every one of us will give account of himself to God. 2 Corinthians 5, verse 10 and 11 says, we must all appear before the judgment seat of Christ. That's a living word, Christ, God's spoken word, Jesus' spoken word to us, that everyone may receive the things done in the body according to he hath done, whether it be good or bad, knowing the terror of the Lord, we persuade men. Now, since God forgives and forgets all of our sins when we repent and ask forgiveness of sin, the only bad thing that will be at the judgment seat of Christ that I can figure are the unforgiven sins, you know, that are acts of sin that we've committed since our salvation when he forgave our sins and made provision for it. Now, you say, well, he forgave all our sins there. Well, he made potential there for all of them to be forgiven. He forgave all of our sins. Listen to 2 Corinthians 2, 10-11. It says, forgive others, lest you give Satan advantage. Now, your sins may be forgiven. You're going to heaven and everything. But if you have unforgiveness in your heart, you're giving the devil advantage in your life. And you're going to have to ask God forgiveness and get back in relationship with him to close that door. 1 Peter 3:7 says, husband, dwell your wives according to knowledge. Being joint heirs of grace of life unto the weaker vessel, lest your prayers be hindered. See, if you got relationship problems there, you got to get that right before, you know, you can have that relationship with God that he wants us to have. And it's evil not to seek him. In 2 Chronicles 12:14 says, Rehoboam did evil because he prepared not his heart to seek the Lord. So if you haven't been seeking God for his will in your life, that's evil. And we need to get those things straightened out here. Those are the things we're going to have to answer for at the judgment seat of Christ, how we've lived as children of God. Now, our sins are forgiven. We're going to heaven and everything. But if you got unforgiveness in your heart, you're out of fellowship with God, and the devil has advantage in your life.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin can now be heard Monday through Friday mornings at 7 a.m. Central, 8 Eastern, and on Saturday and Sunday mornings at 6 a.m. Central, 7 Eastern. Join him and let's turn our country back to God. It only takes a spark to start a forest fire. Let's get on fire for the Lord, right here on KLRN Radio and the Spark Radio Network. Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.
Each of my programs are being saved so that you can listen to them at any time. There's just 4 simple steps to find the past programs. Go to www.spreaker.com. That's S-P-R-E-A-K-E-R.com. Enter my name, Richard Hardin, in the search box in the top center of the home page. Click on the brown icon, which has the Bible, 2 candlesticks, and a cross in the background. A list of my programs will come up. And you know, as Christians, we have a new heart from God and the Spirit of Christ, God's power in us. God is love, and His Spirit is in our hearts. In John, 1 John chapter 4, verse 18, it says, "There's no fear in love, but perfect love, God, casts out fear, because fear is torment. He that feareth is not made perfect in love or God yet." So in James 4, 7, the Scripture says, "Submit therefore to God, or His Spirit in you, resist the devil, fear, and he, the devil and fear, will flee from you." When you start getting apprehensive about something, like starting to fly or a storm coming, looking ahead at what might happen to you in your job, your health, don't just worry and think about these future events, or maybe something that you're even going through right now. Philippians 4:6 says, "When you start getting anxious, turn to God then, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be known to God." Your request and your concern to be known to God. Worrying won't help you one bit, but it will cause you to miss God's blessings to you during that time. So, choose, make the choice yourself to set yourself in submission to God in prayer, talking to God, and counting your blessings from past things, experiences with God. Then watch the devil and fear flee from you. Now, always let your anxiety be a red flag to remind you to pray. God loves you. He will hear you. And in Colossians 1:27, "Christ in us, our hope of glory." So have a good day. God bless you and be set free.
You are listening to KLRN Radio, where liberty and reason still reign.
You're listening to God's Pure Word of Faith with Richard Hardin. Richard will guide you through the Bible and help you find God's purpose for your life. Now here's teacher and author Richard Hardin.
Egypt were the life to the Egyptians, and Jesus' words are life to us. For us to have a walk of faith, we must accept and obey His words. Not only just the words in the Scripture, but words like when He asks us to teach a class or do this or whatever it is in our service and everything. Now, Joseph and Jesus both started at age 30 as priests of the Old Testament, were required to follow, let's see, in Numbers 4, chapter 4, verse 30, says, for 30 years old and upward, even unto 50 years old, shall thou number them, every one that is entered into service to do the work of the tabernacle congregation. And Joseph in Genesis 41:46 says, and Joseph was 30 years old when he stood before the Pharaoh, king of Egypt. He was 30 years old when he was exalted to the second highest position in Egypt. And in Jesus, in Luke 3:23, it says Jesus himself began to be about 30 years of age. See, they fulfill the requirements of their service there in God's will for their life, starting at age 30 there. Joseph and the Pharaoh were in complete agreement of word. Joseph's word ruled the people of Pharaoh's authority delegated and given to him. When Joseph's family came to live in Egypt, Joseph told them to live in Goshen in Genesis 46, verse 28. Well, the Pharaoh agreed in word with Joseph and tells the family to live in Goshen in Genesis 47, 1-6. In fact, the Pharaoh gave all power and authority except the throne unto Joseph to rule by his word. The Father's given all power and authority to Jesus to rule his kingdom, except over the throne. Jesus was the right hand of the Father, position of power, until he was exalted to the fullness of the Godhead bodily, to equality with God. See, that didn't come to after his resurrection. Now, all people had to go to Joseph for salvation food. All people have to go to Jesus for our salvation from our sins, you know, sin debt. And every knee should bow to each one. The Pharaoh willed, and Joseph performed through his word by the authority of the Pharaoh. The Father wills, Jesus performs the Father's will through the living word Christ, whom we often call the Holy Spirit. Because when the Father speaks, when Jesus speaks, the living word Christ goes forth. And now that's the same living word that when God was speaking, remember, to Moses, it says in Hebrews 11:26, Moses esteemed the riches of Christ greater than all the wealth of Egypt. See, the riches of Christ, God speaking to him personally, his living word was Christ there. When God said, let there be light, Christ went forth and presented it. Christ is the creating all power of God. And so when Jesus speaks God's word today, he's speaking the Father's will, he's speaking his word, Christ goes forth. And that's what happens when we turn to God or turn to Jesus for salvation and call out to Jesus. His name has been exalted above all other names for salvation. So we call to Jesus. He responds to us then by sending Christ, the living word, into our heart. Christ in us, our hope of glory. The same living word that created the universe. The same living word that, you know, Mary was conceived by. The same living word that Moses heard and esteemed greater than all the wealth of Egypt. That same living word in us. Romans 8:9 says, now if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. See, that's the creating power that comes in us when we call out to God for forgiveness and creates in us a new heart. See, only Christ can create a heart. Only Christ can, you know, create anything in the universe. God speaks and Christ, his word, goes forth in and performs the creation. So it's God the Father, Jesus speaking today, the upfront of the Trinity, because of God was so pleased with Jesus for what he did that he exalted him through the position of being just a mediator, but to the fullness of God, and gave him the position as the upfront speaker of the Trinity. You know, a God kind of steps back, and well, he spoke at Jesus' baptism, said, my son, whom I'm well pleased, and he also spoke on the Mount of Transfiguration. But since then, God has been letting Jesus be the speaker, it says in Hebrews chapter 1. Now, Jesus is such an important figure today in the Trinity that we turn to him for our salvation. We pray, and you know, to Jesus, and he sends his living word then and rules the kingdom. In Colossians 1:15, the Apostle Paul states, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. Now, just like in Egypt, if people went through the land of Egypt, or strangers appeared in the land of Egypt, in those days when Joseph was performing those tasks and ruling the kingdom, they would have thought he was the supreme ruler, probably. If they weren't aware that the Pharaoh had just exalted him, you know, like strangers from afar come through and ask for food and stuff, they would think, you know, that Joseph was the supreme ruler, because they wouldn't know the history of what had gone on. And today, a lot of people think about, you know, there's people who we call, or a lot of people call, Jesus only, that think that, you know, that Jesus is just the complete God, no Holy Spirit, no Father God, everything like that. But it's just like in Egypt, the physical relationship there, where if the Pharaoh stepped back, gave Joseph the upfront operating of daily issues and ruling the kingdom with his word. Well, God has stepped back. He was so pleased with Jesus that he exalted him to the fullness of Godhead as part of the Trinity. And Jesus speaks a word, and we then are ruled by Jesus. It's easy for people to think then that maybe Jesus is the only, you might say, part of the being of God, but he's not. He's God the Father, Jesus, you know, the Son, exalted to the fullness of Godhead being, and then the Spirit, living Word, Christ, to us. Now, John 10:18, Jesus had the choice to die or not, and he chose to die. That's in John chapter 10, verse 18. That's one reason God was so pleased with him. See, God had given him the right to choose. He didn't have to die on the cross for us. God had given him an out. He could have chose to refuse to do that. But he had the choice, and he made the choice because of his love for us. And he saw beyond the cross what it was going to do. How, you know, we could then come into the fellowship with God and be children of God. And he wanted that for us. He went through all this, you know, knowing that he didn't have to do it. And it says in one place in the scripture, said that God was so pleased with him that he didn't even let his flesh be destroyed. Now, there are so many things like this that we need to, well, be concerned about in our service for the Lord and everything, because he's done so much for us. In let's see here, Acts chapter 2, verses 31 to 36. It said, he, David, seeing this before, spake of the resurrection of Jesus, that his soul was not left in hell, Hades, neither his flesh did see corruption. See, God loved Jesus that much. This Jesus has God raised up, whereof we are all witnesses. Therefore, being by the right hand of God exalted, therefore let all the house of Israel know surely that God has made the same Jesus, the man now, whom you have crucified, both Lord and Christ. See, now today, Jesus and Christ are the same to us, and we say, you know, Jesus Christ or something like this, but on the cross, Jesus was the man Jesus that died on the cross for our sins. And right before he died, he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? See, he had been connected in his heart with the Lord, well, ever since the conception of Mary. You know, the Spirit had been in him, the babe in the womb, and then when he was born, he had had the Spirit of God in his heart all of his life, until right before his death, when Christ left him. Christ left his heart and left him on the cross alone. See, sin now is a separation of the heart from God. So that's when he took on the sins of the world. When Christ left him and he cried out, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? That was the first time he had ever experienced being alone or being without the Spirit of Christ, his Father, in his heart. And he did that for us. He took that sin. When we die this physical death here on earth, our spirit just leaves our body and just goes on to be with the Lord. You know, there's no break in our connection with the Lord. But see, there was for Jesus, and that's when he took our sins and became our sacrifice in that particular case, taking our sins from us and everything, fulfilled the scapegoat's action in the Old Testament sacrifices, where they put all the sins or prayed all the sins onto the scapegoats and led him out in the wilderness to take the people's sins away then. Well, Jesus took our sins away when he died that lonely death on the cross right there at the end. That's why God was so pleased with him, that he went through all that, and God had given him the option to not do it. Like John 10:18 says, Jesus had the choice to die or not. And he says, no man takes his life, but he surrendered. He gave his life because of his love for us. Now, before Jesus was exalted to the fullness of the Godhead bodily, there was God and his living word. In Isaiah 59:21, God says, as for me, this is my covenant with them, saith the Lord. That's his covenant now with the Old Testament people. My spirit that is upon thee, which is mercy, his spirit on them, and my words, Christ, which I have put in thy mouth, shall not depart out of it. See, it was God speaking his word, Christ, to people in the Old Testament. Well, Psalms 25:10 says, all the paths of the Lord, and it says all there, the paths of the Lord are mercy and truth. Now, mercy is God's spirit upon them, like it said in Isaiah, and truth was God's word to them. And he said, to such as keep his covenant testimonies. Now, there were judgments and everything for disobedience, but these were all the words to the godly people. And I have at least about 8 or 9 other scriptures that show in the Old Testament there was not a Trinity relationship. Jesus, the man, was born of Mary. And until he was exalted to the fullness of Godhead bodily, that completed then the Trinity relationship of God that we have today. And so many people, it seems like, argues about like Jesus' deity. No, Jesus wasn't God. Christ was God in Jesus. Christ, the living word in Jesus, just like today. Christ in us, our hope of glory in Colossians 1:27. Christ, the living word in us. See, Jesus was the firstborn of God, the only begotten Son of God. Now, we, it talks about, say, like adopted into the family, because we were born on this earth with no Spirit of God in us. Total sin, see? We were born in total sin. That didn't mean that we were terrible people or anything like that. It was just we were separating our hearts from God. And what started filling our heart then was what our mothers and dads taught us, our schools, what our friends, what our society. And you can see with all the societies around the world, and different kind of people and everything, people's hearts without Christ are just filled with all kind of things. If you look in Ephesians chapter 2, the first five verses of Ephesians chapter 2, the lust of the flesh, the greed, all these things like this. But when Jesus comes or sends his spirit into our heart, the Spirit of Christ in our heart, he creates in us a new heart, a new life, forgives our sins, and puts his Spirit in us, and he lives in us then. See, we go from a dirty, filthy heart, you know, like that, to a cleansed heart with the Spirit of love, Spirit of God. God is love, his Spirit in us. And that's a great change. That's what it means to be born again. All things become new. You know, we're born of the Spirit of God into the body of Christ. And it is so important like that. But then see, God exalted the man Jesus into the fullness of the Godhead bodily. Now, and so we have a Trinity relationship now where it kind of goes along with the physical relationship in Genesis chapters 41 to 50, if you want to look at it some more. Also, on my website, you go to my videos, and I have a video there about the Trinity, which explains this further too. There's so many things that were like this. They both started at age 30, Jesus and Joseph. The people had to bow to both of them, Jesus and Joseph. Well, it's just if you go through all these different relationships like this. In fact, the Pharaoh told Joseph, no man shall lift up a hand or a foot in Egypt, except at your word. And see, we are the word of Jesus now. Every knee shall bow to both of them. Joseph received the ring of authority. Jesus said, all power on earth and heaven and earth is given unto me. So just on and on, you know, that's a physical relationship then, which is similar to our spiritual relationship in the Trinity. But you know, to receive Christ in your heart is the most important thing you do now. He voluntarily died for us because he did not have to do that. He chose to do it because of his love for us and everything. And today, if you can't remember a time when you received that changed heart, all that mess in your heart, lust and greed and all these things in your heart, and you turn to the Lord then and ask his forgiveness, he cleanses your heart. And what is it? 1 John 1:9 says, now if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. See, the Old Testament people didn't get that cleansing, and they didn't get the Spirit to come live in their hearts to become children of God. The work of grace then is what Christ does in us to clean our heart, to create the new heart in us, and to live in our hearts and work in our heart. That's what we call the work of grace. And if you cannot remember that transformation in your life when you called out to God and did that, if you can't remember that, I would like for you to pray with me and invite the Spirit of Christ to come into your heart today, because it just takes a simple, honest prayer. A simple prayer of turning from your sin, or wanting to turn from your sin and turn to the Lord and invite him to come in. In Romans chapter 10, verse 13. Romans 10:13, the scripture says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Now, we can know that we're a sinner. We can know that Jesus is our answer for our sins. Like it says in the book of Romans 6:23, it says, the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God's eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. We can know that, but that's not salvation to us, just knowing and believing it. In James 2:19, says the devils believe and tremble. When Jesus came into the presence of the demons, they cried out to him, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God, why do you torment us for our time? See, just knowing and believing that you're a sinner, knowing and believing that Jesus is the answer, the response is what determines if we become a child of God or not. Do we respond correctly? And the only way to respond is by humbling ourselves, calling out to him, asking forgiveness of our sins, and accepting him into our heart. In Hebrews 4:2, the scripture states that for unto us was the gospel preached as well as unto them. But the word preached unto them did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in them that heard it. See, even though you believe it, know it, there's people right now listening maybe that say, well, I want to wait till I get out of college. I want to wait till I get married. I want to wait till I've sold my wild oats. See, anything the devil can do to cause you to put Jesus off, it'll be easier later and later for you to continue doing that. But see, we must respond properly. And that's, you know, like it said in, you know, Hebrews 11:6, it's impossible to please God without faith. And faith is accepting and obeying his word. And Psalms 119:9, wherewithal shall a young man cleanse his way? By taking heed thereto according to the word. So, by taking heed the fact that we know we're a sinner, we know that Christ is our, or Jesus is our answer, we must humble ourselves then, like it says here in Romans 10:13, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. So I would like to just lead you in a simple prayer, and it doesn't have to be the exact words. You could just say, oh God, help, you know, calling out. 2 Corinthians 3:16 says, when it, the heart of man, turns to the Lord, the veil of separation is lifted. So just a heartfelt cry to God for help, because, you know, most people nowadays don't know all these spiritual words and conditions and things like this and everything, but your heart knows it needs God when you face this point in your life. But I will lead you in these words that kind of represent what, you know, you're doing in your heart, turning to the Lord and everything. So you say, Jesus, I ask you please to forgive me. Cleanse me of all my sins. I want to turn from my sins. I surrender my heart and life to you and invite your Spirit, Christ, to create in me the new clean heart. Live in my heart. In your name, Jesus, I ask. Amen. See, just turning to God with all your heart, inviting him to come in, and to create in you that new heart, new life, talked about in Ezekiel 36:26, where God, speaking through the prophet, said, "A new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and I'll give you heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you." And then when that happens, when the spirit comes in, that's the instant then you become a child of God. When he forgives, cleanses your heart, or creates in you the new heart, new pure heart, you know. And you'll know it's happened, because if you see yourself as a sinner before God, and all that hate and all those lust and all these burdens and everything, you may not know it, but it's about like having a dark cloud over your head, you know, like that. And when he erases that from your heart, forgives your sins, and he says he will remember them no more, you're forgiven and they're forgotten. And that's cleaned up in your heart. It just, oh, such a burden has been lifted. And you will know it. And then when you receive that, like in Galatians 1:27, the Apostle Paul says, "Christ in us, our hope of glory." Christ, the living word of God, has come to live in your heart, into my heart, when we humble ourselves and invite him to come in. And 2 Corinthians 5:17 says, "If any man be in Christ, behold, he's a new creature. Old things passed away. All things become new." See, we aren't just, you might say, given a bath and cleaned up and everything, and, you know, and put on fancy clothes or something. Christ creates in us a new heart, pure heart, and he lives in our heart with love, where before we had all those lust and things like this. Now we have him living in us, the living word of God. In 1 Corinthians 1:24, where again it says that Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom, the pure word of God in our heart. And Christ is love. God is love. So God's love and his power and his pure word in our heart, you'll know that your heart's been changed. And it really is just, it was so exciting going through that. And it's exciting even to think about it again and everything, because it just thrills me to know that I've been born of the Spirit of God into the family of God. In Galatians 4:6, it says, "Because you're sons, God has sent forth the Spirit of his Son into your hearts, crying, Abba, Father. Wherefore you're no more a servant, but a son. And then if a son, then heir of God through Christ." A joint heir with Jesus. You know, as like our elder son, but Jesus is exalted to the fullness of Godhead bodily now. So we're a joint heir to all of those promises that Jesus was fulfilling here on earth. You know, the promises, you know, when he prayed, like in one time when he was praying for Lazarus, that had been dead for about 4 days, and he said, "Father, I know that thou hearest me always, but I say this because of the people standing by here, that they might know that thou hast sent me." So the people heard his prayer, and then he said, "Lazarus, come forth." God answered his prayer. The Spirit of Christ raised Lazarus from the dead, and he came forth as an answer to Jesus' prayer. And, you know, so all those promises like that are ours now as children of God. In Romans 8:9 now, it says, "You're not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be the Spirit of God dwell in you." And it says, "Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his." So, see, it's when we call out to God, and then we'll call out to Jesus, and Jesus answers us by sending his living word, Christ, into our heart. The instant the living word comes into our heart, we are changed to become a child of God. Like it says in Romans 8:9, "Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ, none of his." So, before the Spirit of Christ comes in our heart, we're his creature, yes, we were born on earth, but we all born in total sin without any of God's Spirit in us. Now when we receive the Spirit of Christ into our heart, we become a child of God, he's living in us, and we're a different creature. We start out with a pure heart, Christ living in us at salvation. Now, there's still problems in our lives that we need to, you know, take care of, you know, like it says in 2 Corinthians 2:10-11, "Forgive others lest you give Satan advantage." See, we can be giving away part of our relationship, opening a door to the devil to come in and bring sicknesses and curses and things like this to us if we don't walk according to the rules of the, you know, kingdom. And the rules of the kingdom is, it's in cleansing from the sin. Ezekiel 36:26, God speaking through the prophet there said, a new heart also will I give you, a new spirit will I put within you. I'll take away the stony heart of the flesh, give you heart of flesh, and I'll put my spirit in you. See, that's what happens to us. We get so much more than the forgiveness. As great as that is, the forgiveness, and then God completely forgets our sins in. But we get the new heart and his spirit in us, and we become a child of God. We're born again then into the body of Christ, into the, you know, God's family by the spirit coming into our heart when he changes us. Well, see, now today I'm going to be talking about the Trinity, the relationship of God, the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And then following up next Sunday, I'm going to continue then to look at some of the relationships between Jesus and Christ, and explain it further Sunday. But today I'm going to try to share with you about the Trinity. And like I said, I'll have some new information for you. You know, when you meet a new person in our society, and you're going to have a relationship with them, like a new employee, or you go to a new job yourself and meet the new boss or something like this, one of the first things you start doing is conversing back and forth, you know, kind of asking questions and sharing your likes and dislikes and seeing what their likes and dislikes are, so you can get to know them. Because in this relationship, you're expected, you know, to fit in some way or another. Well, that's the way it is with the Lord. When we come and invite him to come into our heart, and he comes into our heart and we become a child of God, we need to be studying this relationship of God and what kind of characteristics he has. You know, if you have a boss that dislikes certain things, well, you certainly don't want to start doing those things. You know, as soon as you become an employee, you want to keep from doing those type things. But first, in 2 Peter chapter 1, verse 2, it says, grace and peace be multiplied to you through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. So the more we can know and understand about God and the type of relationship we should have, like it says in, let's see, Hebrews 11:6, one of the most important scriptures to tell us about our relationship between us and God is that in Hebrews 11:6 it says, but without faith it's impossible to please God, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, you know, that he is God, that he can do these things, and the promises he's given us, he can back them up. But must, for he that cometh to God must believe that he is, and that he's a rewarder of them that diligently seek him. But that first statement there, but without faith it's impossible to please God. See, now this is a big important scripture for our relationship with God. We can only please him through faith, it says. Now faith comes by hearing the word of God, but only if we accept and obey what we hear. So for us to be pleasing to God, we've got to be accepting his word, and it's got to be his pure word. It can't be just anything you decide sounds good or something. But anyway, we need to be studying about God, and that's what I'm going to share with you this morning. It's about the Trinity, the relationship we have now. In a recent poll I heard being discussed on the radio, the host stated that only about one-third of the people who profess to be Christians in the United States actually believe that Jesus is the only way for a person to be forgiven of sin and made right with God. Also, they stated that many of the leaders do not even believe in the virgin birth. Now see, our image of God is so very critical, for it, you know, it determines how we seek to relate to him. And to be pleasing to him, you know, we've got to relate in a certain way. And it also gives us a value or importance of our lives and the lives of others, is how we feel about God and what God expects of us, and things like this. And so I want to try to help clear up some of this confusion now about the images of God and the personalities of the Trinity, because these images are so important to us. Now, so, and then I will continue on in the next message and be more specific about, you know, Christ and Jesus and their relationship and things like this. And you probably don't realize it, what I'm getting at now, but you will before the message is over. Now, in the Trinity, You know, the more we can know about...
Visit Richard's website at rahardin.com. That's the World Wide Web at rahardin.com. At his website, you can see a summary of the 6 books he has written, where purchases may be made. He also has a link to 18 videos on YouTube and several blogs about Christian beliefs. If you prefer, visit amazon.com/Kindle and type in Richard Hardin to see and purchase his books.